Thank you. ciao, eh?
Einer, glaube ich. Herzlich willkommen hier heute Abend in der Bali. Mein Name ist Juri Albrecht, ich bin der Direktor der Bali. Wir sind ganz froh, dass Herr Sarrazin aus Berlin hierher gekommen ist. Ich würde den Rest des Abends auf Englisch reden, weil wir die Debatte auf Englisch halten, aber ich möchte gerne herzlich willkommen sagen, Herr Sarrazin und Herr Stahl. Beides hier in Holland, in Amsterdam. Very happy to have you here all. We have an interesting debate tonight, I would say. We're very happy to have Thilo Sarrazin and Paul Scheffer to have a debate on migration, on Europe, on Germany. I would introduce the two speakers to you. But first I'd like to say, switch off your mobile phones. I mean, I don't mean switch them off, but you can easily use Twitter, but don't make them ring. We organized this debate also thanks to Katharina Rinsema and Christian Stahl in Berlin and Rinsema here in the Bali. This is the first time Herr Sarrazin speaks in Holland, which is actually quite amazing because he's a prolific writer and controversial writer in Germany. And since we are a debating center, we thought it might be a good idea to bring the controversy here to Amsterdam. Paul Scheffer and Thilo Sarrazin will be speaking on migration, which is a hotly debated topic for the last decade at least. Thilo Sarrazin is a German politician for the SPD, former member of the executive board of the Deutsche Bundesbank. He was a senator of finance in the state of Berlin. That would be something like an alderman, I would suppose, here in Holland. And he wrote over 15 books. He wrote in 2010, Deutschland schafft sich ab, one of the most popular books on politics in the German language in a decade. More than 1.5 million copies were sold. And he wrote this year another book, Germany braucht den Euro nicht. And the book argues that introduction of a single currency in Europe in the form of the euro was a bad idea and should be overturned. He wrote actually more books on it. In 1997 already, Der Euro, Chance oder Abenteuer. Und dann im 98, in 1998, all those languages. Anyway, Der Euro. the Buch. The book Deutschland schafft sich ab, das war also wirklich umstritten. Die SPD hat versucht, ja, da bin ich wieder auf Deutsch. Ja. The German Labour Party tried to chuck him out, actually to sort of say it colloquially, but in the end decided not to suspend his membership. Paul Scheffer, I don't need to introduce him for this audience, I would say, very long. He's, of course, a well-known journalist and writer in our country. He's also a well-known professor. He's professor in the Wieboud Leerstuhl an der UvA. He was for almost 10 years. And he is now, for more than a year, professor in European Studies in the University of Tilburg, writing on a very interesting topic on the outsiders looking in on Europe, which is expected at the book, I don't know, in about a year time, I hope. He is the writer of The Multiculturele Drama in 2000, an essay for the NRC Handelsblad, which has been quoted over and over again. And he is, among other books, he wrote Een tevreden natie, Nederland en het wederkerend geloof in de Europese status quo. I'm not trying to translate that in any language. Anyway, Het Land van Aankomst, The Land of Destination, I would say, but it's translated differently, I think, the title in English. But Immigrant Nations, I wouldn't have thought about that. I would, no. Het Land van Aankomst. So we're happy that the two of you are here and are willing to talk about the issues of migration. And I'm very happy that Christian Stahl helped us to organize this. He's a documentary maker in Berlin. His documentary will be shown tomorrow evening here, and with your card you can actually go there with the card you bought tonight to see it. It's a splendid documentary about multiculturalism, the drama of the integration, I would say, actually, integration in the German situation. Okay, I'd like to give the floor to Mr. Thilo Sarrazin. Please, Mr. Sarrazin.
Arthur, thank you very much. Dear ladies and gentlemen, during the most part of not my professional career, I was an economist. I started out as an economist, but I soon became a civil servant in the Ministry of Finance in Germany. And I must say, I was, for the most part of my professional life, both the dedicated economist and dedicated civil servant. It was only in the late stage of my the career that I took the political office. I have always tried to understand the driving forces behind the development of economies, of societies, and of peoples. And so I have, as an amateur, I must say, taken interest in history, in the political philosophy, and in the, not the emergence and the decline of peoples and of cultures. I say as an amateur, because as a professional, I'm the economist and the civil servant. My interest in the demographic, the questions, started in 1972, when I dealt for the first time with the long-term, the consequences of the steep fall of the birth rate in Germany. This fall of the German birth rate started in 1965. In only 5 years at that time, the net, the reproduction rate, this is the average number of children per woman, fell from the post-war level of 2 children to 1.4 children. And this, the level has been stable for the last 45 years. As a result, the absolute number of births in Germany fell from the 1.4 million in 1965 to the 663,000 in 2011. If this trend goes on, one can exactly calculate the time when the Germany will be the smaller than Holland, at least as regards the people. For a long time, the stability of this trend was denied in most German discussions. First, this won't go on. Then this is not so bad. We are so many anyway, and so on. But when this could not be denied anymore, then it's the long-term implications for the economy and for the society were played down. At the beginning, this was quite easy, because it takes 30 years for the generation to grow up and to enter the labor market. As in most Western countries, the post-war boom and the growing scarcity of cheap labor had caused an influx of the migrant workers, mostly from European countries, but later on more and more from Turkey, Africa, and the Near and Middle East. The number of the asylum seekers grew as well, and the attractiveness of the German welfare system did the rest. I think this has been pretty much the same story in most countries of the Northern and Western Europe. Since the 80s, the German discussions of the demography on the one hand and the migration on the other hand, they were more and more mixed up. Migration was presented as the solution for the looming demographic gap. This gap could not be denied anymore, because the trend had then already been going on for the 25 years. And so the issue of the migration was welcome for playing down the consequences of the low birth rate. The idea or the ideology of the multiculturalism also played a role. Since the World War II, many mainstream thinkers in the German media and in the humanities were ill at ease with the fact that they were doomed to live in Germany as Germans. They hoped that the German people, the German country, and the German culture would dissolve into something bigger and better, that the German ugly duck, as they conceived themselves, would emerge as the European swan. This was the new expression for the longing for the Weltgeist, as described in Hegel's The Philosophy, the Weltgeist is something that gives sense and the purpose to the course of history. The Weltgeist also drove communism. This attitude of the Weltgeist that nourished both the German enthusiasm for the unified Europe and the hoped for the emergence of the multicultural society in Europe. Those who expressed the skepticism tended to be ridiculed as backward and the provincial, if not worse. Time and again, there occurred discussions about the integration of immigrants, which pointed at certain problems, but those discussions died away quickly. See, the official German policy on migration and integration has always treated and is still treating immigrants and foreigners as the uniform group. It has been the official policy to deny or play down the influence of ethnic, cultural, and the religious the backgrounds of migrants and of their offspring. Only the role of the Islam and the influence of the radical Islamic thinking on some groups were taken more seriously since the end of the 90s, not especially since 9/11. Myself, I used to have a very pragmatic view on migration. My thinking was that of an economist. It was quite clear to me that the demographic problems could not be solved and hardly be alleviated with any kind of the migration, for the simple reasons that babies don't immigrate. Only gradually did the role of ethnic, cultural, and the religious differences dawn on me. I was married, and I still am married to a teacher. And since the early 70s, a number of our friends have been teachers, but for a long time I regarded the evidence that I got from them as mainly the anecdotal. Only when I became the senator of finance in the state of Berlin, I began to concern myself with the statistical evidence and the research on the background of immigrants, as well as the speed and success, or in some cases, the lack of speed of success of the integration in the labor market and in the society, because this was a big driver for the public expenditure in Berlin, and so for the deficit. The evidence was crushing. Immigrants from Eastern Europe, from Southern Europe, with the slight exception of maybe Southern Italy, from India and from the Far East, integrate in Berlin and all over Germany, they're generally very well. And the second generation, most indicators for these the groups of immigrants are favorable. Especially descendants from immigrants from the Far East do also in Germany, they're much better in school and in the labor markets than the Germans themselves. This part of the statistical picture in Germany resembles the evidence in the United States, in Canada, Australia, and in the UK. The bulk of problems with integration in the first generations and virtually all the problems in the second generations of immigrants and in later generations are connected with the migrants from Turkey, Africa, the Near and Middle East, with the exception of migrants from Iran and the migrants with the Christian faith. They have somewhat different and better indicators. These are the groups with the highest birth rates, with the lowest the labor market integration, with the lowest educational performance, with the highest dependency on the welfare, and with the highest criminality, same as in the Netherlands. Of course, the performance of these groups is not the uniform. They are also the produce achievers, but taken all in all, the results are disturbing, and the progress is slow, even in the third and in the fourth generation of these immigrants. Together with the low German birth rates, this constitutes the structural problem, which is getting worse over time. The general shift in the socio-economic structure of the families of the newly born in Germany aggravates the problem further. The better educated and the brighter the parents, the fewer the babies, and vice versa. In my book, Deutschland schafft sich ab, I took an integrated approach to questions of the demography, of education, of the structure, organization of the welfare system, of the labor market, of culture, the religion, immigration, and integration, and analyzed the long-term consequences for the German future. The outlook was disturbing, and this was reflected in the public discussions, which was heated and the controversial. I did not make a prediction in my book, because one can never predict the future. At the utmost, one can shed light, shed some light on evident risks and on the likely developments, and it was what I did. Taken all in all, the emotional, the character of the public reaction to my book, either hostile or enthusiastic, that surprised me, and it somehow shocked me. But the emotions are not always a bad thing. In politics as well as generally in life, nothing ever changes, nothing ever is the getting done without the driving force of the human will. The human will that uses the tools of rational reasoning for its ends, but the source of its strength and of its direction is always emotional. Early in the preparation of my book, at the beginning of 2009, I came across Paul Schäffer's name, and I read the German translation of Het Land van Ankomst, which is called in German Die Eingewanderten, der Toleranz in einer grenzenlosen Welt. The subtitle seems to be coming from the lector of the book, which obviously wanted to give it somewhat more the positive touch than it actually had. Whatever, the translation was published in 2007. I was fascinated by this work. It greatly influenced my book. It directed my thinking, and it influenced many of the questions with which I confronted the German situation. Of course, the scope of both books is different with regard to historical, the sociological and cultural aspects of immigration and integration. Paul Schäffer's book digs much deeper in my book I have a broader, the broader focus on the future of the German society and its driving forces, between which the structure of the future immigration and the policy of it play an important role. In my concluding remarks, I address the matters of immigration and integration with regard to the future in Europe. The Europe as a whole, however you define it, you have the choice. The Eurozone, the EU, the whole of Europe, including Russia, however you define it, the Europe as a whole is aging and its population is dwindling due to low birth rates. In those countries where the birth rates are still near or somewhat above the reproduction level, the higher birth rates of the Muslim immigrants plays an important role for this statistical outcome. It can easily be shown that the further immigration from Africa, near and Middle East, produces more cost financially and economically, as well as in terms of the social and of cultural tensions, than it produces benefits in moral, financial, and economic terms. At the same time, further migration to Europe does not solve the problems in those regions where the migrants come from. And these the problems are high population growth, backward economies, weak institutions. In the 1900, 110 years ago, the whole of Africa had a population from the 133 million people, a third of the population of Europe. Presently, Africa has a population of the 1 billion, the 22 million people, which is the 40% more than the whole of Europe from the Gibraltar to the Ural. And in the next 90 years, until 2100, the population in the Africa will more than triple to the 3.6 billion people, then more than five times the size of the population of Europe. These numbers are from the new population estimate of the United Nations. These estimates are generally pretty accurate. In 1950, the Nations predicted exactly the size of the world population in the year 2000. If only a small part of this the population growth, the migrates to Europe, the sheer number is the problem for the European tradition, for the European way of life, and for the European economic standards, without really helping the regions they come from, because which is a trickle for them is a broad stream for us. In view of this perspective, there's a sensible course that for Europe is undoubtedly to prevent further immigration from Africa, the Near and Middle East. At the same time, the integration and assimilation of all immigrants in Europe, which are already legally here, should of course be intensified and accelerated. In this regard, we have to be true to our culture and tradition. Although this double approach, stop for the further immigration from Africa, Near Middle East, integration and assimilation of those who are already here, is the sensible It is not the likely to occur. It's the same as with the euro. The long view interested the long view interests very few people, the least of all the majority of the politicians. It's easier to muddle through and concentrate on the relieving the very next pain, and then the next, and then the next, and so on. I'm afraid this kind of strategic genius, which presently rules the savings of Greece, will also form the future policies of immigration and integration in Europe. This means one will do too little until it is too late, and then will one say, now it is too late. For the euro, as well as for the European immigration and integration, it is tempting to predict the future course of events, and there are good reasons to paint that future in dark colors. But for today, as I already said, it's always difficult to make predictions. I will resist this temptation, and I will finish with quoting two the German poets. First, Friedrich Hölderlin from 1802. Nah ist und der schwer zu fassende Gott, wo aber Gefahr ist, wächst das Rettende auch. Yeah, very well said. And the other quote is from Friedrich Schiller. Das Alte stürzt, es ändert sich die Zeit, und neues Leben blüht aus den Ruinen. Thank you very much.
Herzlichen Dank, Herr Sarrazin. Thank you very much for your introduction, for your thoughts. We've asked Paul Scheffer, who've seen your speaking notes, to react to it. And after that, we will continue the debate between the two of you. And later on, we hope that the audience will join in as well. Thank you very much, Herr Sarrazin. Paul Scheffer, to you.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to meet you here. I've, of course, followed the debate in Germany after your book was published. You say you were astonished by the emotional reactions. To some extent, I was astonished too, but I had a small preview after my own book was translated in Germany, and I went there to have quite a few debates. Of course, I felt immediately, like in the Netherlands, although to some extent for different historical reasons, that the debate was, of course, quite difficult, very charged by the shadows of history, and in many senses not easy. Of course, one of the great things about discussions across borders is that emotions don't travel easily. I mean, what happened in the Netherlands was, of course, that many of the things that were said about immigration provoked a lot of debates, but when you cross borders, of course, a more detached view is possible, and the same will happen probably here, and has happened here, because, of course, there has been quite a few articles about your book and about discussions in Germany, but largely with a far more detached view, because perhaps, and this says a lot about the possibilities of a European public sphere, that emotions are so tied to language and language communities that they don't travel easily. As for the subtitle, you're quite correct in your thinking that the subtitle of my book was not directly my first preference. My proposal was Die offene Gesellschaft und ihre Grenzen as a subtitle, The Open Society and Its Borders. But then people told me in Germany that they went to the bookshops with that subtitle, and that it somehow didn't work at all, and that the word Toleranz somehow fitted general purposes of selling and buying better. I want to react basically to two of your remarks. First, on what I think is absolutely a good starting point, and that is your observations you make about demography and immigration. And I'm always astonished to the extent that demography doesn't play much of a role in public debates, definitely not in the Netherlands. But if you look at it, and I won't repeat all the figures that you gave, but if you look at the situation today in the European Union with 27 nations, roughly 500 million people, this population will reach its peak by 2040 with 226 million people and then slowly decline. Europe is the only continent today where the average birth rate is under the replacement level. So if we wouldn't have any migration, the population overall would be shrinking already. The average is now 1.6, where it should be a little bit above 2, as is easily can be understood. As of today, 20% of the growth in Europe, population growth, is excess of birth. 80% is due to immigration. If you look at the US or Canada, which is of course quite a relevant comparison, then you see that where Europe is very marginally, only with 3% in the next 40 years, the population is growing. At the same period, the population of the United States will grow with 36%, in Asia 25%, not to speak of Africa. So the share of the European population will decline further in the next decades, from a little bit above 7% as it is now, to somewhat above 5% of the world population in the next 40 years. So the first couple of questions this rough development should raise and doesn't provoke in the public debate in across Europe is, what does it tell us about the vitality of our societies? Because it's a unique constellation historically. It's a unique constellation if we compare the European continent with other continents. What does it tell us? That we have a growing population, which is not the same as a shrinking population, but definitely in a couple of European countries, we already see populations shrinking. What does it tell us? It's a common wisdom among demographers that a bulk of young people is a cause of innovation, political reform, not to speak of revolution. So the Arab Spring is always connected in the public mind and in analysis with a relatively young population. Well, skip the relative here. I think 50% of the population of Egypt is under 16 years. So, but why wouldn't the opposite be true, that a graying and shrinking population somehow diminishes the capacity for innovation, the capacity for economic growth, and also that in a time of globalization, when the needs for adaptation and innovation are perhaps bigger than ever, a population that we are witnessing as it is developing in the coming decades is perhaps ill-suited for that circumstance? So that would be the first question to ask. Why isn't there a debate about what does it tell us that our population is graying and shrinking? A second remark on demography and immigration would be that we have to see the differences inside Europe. Germany is definitely not the example of Europe, generally speaking. There are wide differences when we look at demographic developments inside Europe. And that, of course, raises interesting questions as well. If we look at Finland, Norway, Sweden, UK, France, and Ireland, definitely not all related, as you suggested, to higher birth rates of the Muslim population. If you look at those countries which have, of course, for decades already, a policy with regard to family and with regard to gender that is not the European mainstream, we see fertility levels of 1.9 to 2.1, whereas in Germany, Italy, and Eastern Europe, on the other end of this divide with 1.2, 1.3. So the question is, of course, how can these differences be explained? Very complicated question, but it suggests at least, if we look at France, for example, which has followed already for a period just beginning after the Second World War, a policy with regard to those demographic developments, that intervention, that public debate about it matters, and that we simply shouldn't take those long-term developments as a natural given, but as an object also of inquiry and dispute. Third remark on demography and immigration is that immigration, as you said, cannot be the answer to demographic stagnation or decline. Not only because babies don't immigrate, which I found a nice way to summarize a whole library of books about this topic, but perhaps simply given the sheer size of immigration that would be needed to keep the ratio of people under 65 and people above 65 at the level as it is now. The same United Nations Bureau of Population has calculated this, for example, for the Netherlands. The size of immigration that we would need in the next 30 years to have the demographic balance as it is now. The Netherlands would need a net immigration of 300,000 people every year, 10 times the level it is now. And then in 2050, the Netherlands would have 39 million inhabitants. The problem with this is not only that it's quite a sizable presence in a small country, but then, of course, the problem of graying reoccurs because migrants have the obnoxious tendency to become older as well. So then in 2050, the whole problem would start all over again. So politicians like to emphasize all the time that immigration is the answer to demographic decline, and it's simply not true. Immigration can be a small part of the solution, but the vast question that lies behind shrinking and graying populations is, of course, a question of retirement age, a question of reform of the welfare state, a question of productivity, and so forth, and so forth. So that is, I think, important to remark those questions about demography and immigration, because they get confused all the time if people speak about it at all. Then the second question, which of course has given perhaps provoked most debate about your book and also what you've emphasized today, and that is the relation between ethnicity and integration, especially in social economic terms. Whereas you say different migrant communities perform differently in the labor market, in the schooling system, and generally speaking, socioeconomic integration has a clear link to ethnic, cultural, or religious differences. As you stated in your speech here, the bulk of the problems are connected with migrants from Turkey, Africa, Near and Middle East, and then you specify, with the exception of migrants from Iran and migrants with a Christian faith. So the implication is the bulk of the problems within the Muslim community, not so much ethnicity as religion. And one should differentiate, of course, as a beginning point, very clearly between the two, because history suggests that ethnicity fades over time, that ethnic affiliation becomes less and less relevant from one generation to the other, whereas religion tends to persevere in a society much longer. So, The main thesis is then that religion, or the Muslim communities, generally speaking, that there the main problems concentrate in terms of labor participation, educational performance, crime, etc. Looking at the Netherlands, one could say that there is ample evidence for this idea, but I definitely want to qualify your suggestion in three ways. First, if we look at the United States today, it's definitely not the Muslim communities or migrants from the Near East or the Middle East or Morocco that are, economically speaking, in the worst situation. They tend to be more middle class than the same migrants arriving in Europe. And the main problems in socio-economic terms are with the Mexican immigrants. So that relativizes immediately, if we look at the experience of the United States, the clear nexus between religion or culture and socioeconomic performance. Second remark would be looking at the history of migration, that generally speaking, there has always been a temptation to make a direct link between ethnicity and low expectations about assimilation. But that was true for the German immigrants in America. We all know what Benjamin Franklin wrote about those immigrants. He said they're trying to Germanize America. They're trying to overtake our culture. But also, if you look at the reactions to the Irish, the Italians, the Chinese of all, 65 years America had the Chinese Exclusion Act, where it was impossible for people with a Chinese background to become American citizen. Why? Because their ethnicity was deemed to be inferior. So we should keep that in mind a little bit when speaking about today's expectations and worries that almost every migrant community throughout history, the Italians in Marseille, the Polish in Germany, the Irish in Britain, et cetera, not only in America, but also in Europe, were met with low expectations about the possibility of their assimilation. Thirdly, we should always keep in mind, when speaking about the Muslim communities in Germany and the Netherlands, that their presence overlaps with the history of guest workers. So those were people specifically selected for their low qualifications in terms of education. I'm making, with two people who are here in the audience, a film about migration as it happened in the last 50 years. And then you see also a sequence of the way the guest workers were selected. Somebody enters the room, somebody of the Duff factory is sitting there, looking over his glasses with a penetrating view, and then guy comes in, and the first question is, you speak French? Oui, monsieur. How many years you have in school? 8 ans, monsieur. Go away. Too many years of qualification. So we selected people with the lowest qualification, and that there is such a strong overlap between that history and the presence of a new religious community should never be forgotten. And then I come to my perhaps most crucial remark where we could have a difference. I think you are underestimating, generally speaking, generational change. I've just done a research based on existing material between Amsterdam and Rotterdam. We had sort of 100 criteria of integration on all different fields. And if you look at them, it suggests definitely more generational change than you, in your gloomy vision, imply. Of course, we should always remember that still of today, as in Germany, in the Netherlands, the first generation is larger than the second generation, but your side remark about the third and fourth generation simply doesn't hold empirically, because if you look at the third generation, it's already very, very small, only in its beginnings. If we look at those groups about whom you are talking, you know, their migration started in the 60s. We're in the second generation, the third generation. It's almost the same story as in the Netherlands, started almost at the same time. And if you look at the third generation, for example, in Amsterdam, it's almost non-existent still. Very, very small as compared to the second, and even insignificant as compared to the first. So the whole question of where generational change will bring us is, in my view, open. But then, if I look at the outcomes of this research, for example, you say the Muslim communities have a high fertility rate, many children in those families. It's simply not true. If you look at the second generation, you see a steep decline in the size of families, also in the Muslim communities. So I looked, for example, at the statistics of when women in the Muslim communities, the Moroccan community, Turkish community, in the Netherlands, get their first child. In 1994, it was at the age of 22. Now it's at the age of 28. So in 15 years' time, you see almost a convergence with the native average. Not completely there. Native average is 32 years old, but definitely the size of families in the Muslim communities in the Netherlands, but that's true in Germany as well. If you look at the generational change, you see somewhat more movement than you imply. Also, if I look at educational performance in the second generation, I would qualify it as a growing divide, a growing polarization. On the one hand, you see the emergence of a middle class. On the other hand, you see too many, and too many literally means too many, who are stuck on the lower sides of our educational system. So you see within this supposed migrant community, which isn't a community at all, but is a general term under which different lives are caught. But if you look at the second generation already, and I predict a third generation, will give way to a growing pluralism in the destinies of those whom grandparents came from Morocco or Turkey. If we look at crime, then I would say, yes, there is quite a high crime rate in the Moroccan community, but definitely also in the Netherlands, in the Antillean community. They strike out definitely both. If we look at the Turkish community, the crime rate there is significantly lower than the Moroccan community, Surinamese community as well. So the whole question, which I think determines far more, is family culture, and religion can play a role there, but I would say those who tend to be seduced by crime are not particularly described by devout religious obedience, on the contrary. So I think it's more general. When you look at migration patterns, the breakdown of family structures, the breakdown of parental authority, which also explains why in the first generation the crime rates are very low, and in the second generation, typically, which is caught between the land of arrival and the land of destiny, the land of origin, then you see how much they are caught between different codes of authority. Two conclusions very briefly. First, I do agree that we need a restrictive immigration policy, but I disagree that ethnicity or religion should be the guiding factor. I would say let's adopt what Canada is doing, let's adopt what Australia is doing, let's look at qualifications, and let's be very clear about that our great question is, what are we going to do with the second, third generation living already here? What is their answer to them? Their definitely above average unemployment, still also in the second generation. The welfare system has a lot to do with that, I guess. So there I would look at those questions. With regard to integration, I would say, yes, we need more emphasis, but what is the normative framework? I would say the normative framework is reciprocity. Simply, the native population cannot ask more, but shouldn't ask less of newcomers than it's asking of itself. So the criterion here is civic integration. And I think the whole immigration and integration debate has somehow brought into the open our weakness in terms of a culture of citizenship. But that is true for our society, generally speaking. So, for example, when we talk about religious freedom, we should tell everybody it's a right, but it entails a responsibility to defend the same right for those with whom you deeply disagree. That is a problem within the Muslim community. It's also a problem within the majority population, as we see in Switzerland. So yes, it confronts the Muslim community, should confront them, but it should also answer the question raised by a minister in Germany of Turkish descent, who said, why is it that we are told all the time as Muslim communities, separation of state and church, and that we still have crucifixes in our public school, on the school wall, and then you can't say it's our tradition? Then either your tradition is the separation of state and church, or your tradition is Christian, but then minorities can say it's our tradition to have our symbols in our public sphere. So I would say let's remain truthful to the idea of citizenship, also in its normative sense, but that opens a possibility for conflict, not only with Muslim communities, but also should confront majority populations. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Paul Scheffer. Indeed, there's water underneath your tables. What's it? Tabernacles. Anyway, and you have to wait till the end of the of the debate to have a water or a beer. Mr. Zazen, you made notes. You probably have a few things to answer.
I would like to make that are some remarks. First, concerning the vitality of our culture, this is indeed a question to which I have, which I don't have any clear answers for, but I think that there is an answer for the question why the democracy is not the subject in the media. So look at the media, look at the not the average, not the journalists, count their marriages, count their divorces, count those who have always been unmarried, count the number of children, count the share of those who don't have children at all. And then you can see that the raising the family is an the exception and the, not the rule the within the media crowd. So I assume, or I, yes, well, I assume or I suspect that the family and the children don't belong to the normal environment of the journalists anymore, and that therefore there are no the subject for them, and so are not the long-term the consequences as well. This is the first point which I want to make. That the second point is France. France is an interesting example. And there you see the long-term effects of debates and of the feeling of the society. France used to have the biggest population in the Europe. At the site of the Napoleon Wars, France had about 50% more population than in Germany, which explained part of its the military success. It had simply more young soldiers. These things changed because France modernized quickly. The birth rate started to fall in France immediately after the Napoleonic Wars, and when the German-French War took place in 1870, the German-Prussian army simply had got more the soldiers than the French armies, and this was a matter of a great concern for the French. And so after the First World War, when the same story had repeated itself, the French people started the population policy, but which only started to succeed at the beginning of the 50s. And for the French, if you look at the French media, even with my insufficient command of French, I see that matters of the demography there play a much more not a prominent role in France than in Germany, and there is an endless stream of articles and features when and why the France that will overtake the Germany as regards population. So this is quite interesting, but otherwise you are right. It's still a mystery to me regarding the vitality of the societies. Now to the different immigrant groups. The evidence in the Germany is really startling. We have the few immigrants from the Far East, mostly from the Vietnam in the West Germany, as boat people from the South Vietnam, in Eastern Germany as the guest workers from the North Vietnam, but it's It's really interesting that in East Berlin and all over East Germany, about 80% of the other children of the Vietnamese immigrants that reach the highest the school level, makes the Bachelor-Abitur, however it is called in the Netherlands, and it's quite a difference. And the interesting thing is, if you look at the United States and of the long-term experience with the migrant workers from the Japan and from China, then there are interesting results. In the 20s of the last century, coolies from the Japan and the China that constructed the railways in Canada, and the administration then was really quite racist and conservative, the colonial administration, and they were very surprised by the fact that the children of the coolies, which had to work at the railways, did much better in school than the white children did. And the same goes for the United States today. There is a stable relationship in the United States between the so-called SAT score, that is the test which everybody takes after the end of the high school, between the average SAT score and the ethnic origin. By far at the top of the average SAT score are the descendants of immigrants from Far East. It's not important whether they are from Vietnam, Cambodia, China, Japan, wherever. They do much better in school. They get the better jobs, and they even have a longer. They have a higher income than the whites, and they even have a longer life expectancy of about 6 years compared to the whites. And then in the ranking order, there are the people from Far East, then there are the white, the American white, then there are the so-called Chicanos, the people from Mexico, and so on. And then there is a black population, and the relation of the SAT scores has been as stable since the 40 or 50 years, no change at all. And the same experience is being made in Australia and in the Canada. And this means that immigration in these countries, which comes mostly from Far East and only to the small part from Africa or the Near Middle East, that immigration in these countries actually raises the qualification level of the country, whereas with our immigration, it's the opposite, and this is the problem, and that is the reason why immigration has to be selective in some way, and because I know politics, I am always in favor of quite the simple regulation. And the easiest regulation would be the regional one. As regards the change from the generation to the generation, this change occurs indeed also in Germany with immigrants from Turkey and from the Arab country, but it goes pretty slow, and it is in some regions even going backward. And of course, we do have the the fourth the generation in school now in Germany. The first the generation came around 1965. The second generation was born at that time, at the end of the 60s. The third generation was born in the 80s, and now the children of the third generation are in school, and they are 6 and 7 and 8 and 10 years old, and they have a large degree exactly the same problems.
But family reunification happened 20 years later. Mm-hmm. So the bulk of family reunification in Germany and the Netherlands only happened at the end of the 80s and throughout the 90s. So in that sense, the generational view that you propose, I think, underestimates that time gap.
Well,
and if I look at the statistical evidence for Germany and the Netherlands, which is roughly comparable, I would still maintain it. If you look at the generational build-up of migrant communities in Cologne or Stuttgart or Frankfurt, that you typically see that the first generation still is the largest, second generation coming close to the size of the first generation, and the third generation in its beginnings, but still very weak. So the longer view, which we can have if we look at all our migration communities, still I think the verdict is a bit open. As you suggest yourself, you don't make predictions, but perhaps that would be also in generational terms. I would maintain, looking also at France, at Algerian communities, that the third generation goes slower than often expected. Mm-hmm. But if we look at the evidence of previous generation of immigration histories, it often went much slower than we now tend to assume. Also in the United States, big problems with the second generation of the Italian migrants, with the Polish migrants, with the Irish migrants, all the forms of segregation, crime. If you look at Little Italy in Chicago or comparable ethnic communities in Boston. So I started where you started, so to say. But then reading that evidence of migration history, I became a bit more cautious, or if you want to put it that way, a bit more optimistic with the possibilities of generational change in our time as well. I think if we compare social mobility throughout Northwestern Europe with America, there's not so much difference if we look at generations of migrants. Your story about the Asian migrants, I would subscribe to, but if we look at Europe, the problem with Asian migrants is that most of them, and then we forget those who were already in the Netherlands for 100 years, because their story is definitely not a story of social mobility and educational achievement. Those communities that arrived in Amsterdam and Rotterdam 100 years ago. But if we look at present-day Asian migrants, they tend to be refugees, and refugees tend to be far more with a middle-class background than the guest workers. So one should always... I think it's true that there is more of a culture of learning and investing in the education of children in, for example, Chinese community or Asian communities, generally speaking. I think that is true, a cultural preference that definitely puts more investments of parents in the education of children. But I would, when looking at the Mexican immigrants, it's not a coincidence that many have said the Mexicans are the Muslims of America, so to say. In terms of educational achievement or labor participation, the situation is definitely not good. And even those with a very sympathetic view of immigration in America are deeply worried about the position of Mexican immigrants, and especially their offspring, and especially also those who are undocumented, 13 million as we speak. So,
if I may...
That complicates the picture a bit.
I agree, the Mr. picture Zan, is grey, but even where it is grey, it is somehow... or at some places not disturbingly stable. For example, in Germany, there were the immigrants from Turkey or from Morocco are in employment and live they're more dispersed. For example, in the Munich and Stuttgart, integration is much better than there where they live in the clusters and tend to be unemployed.
And with Mercedes-Benz.
This is one point. And with regards to the birth rate, I also did some research about that for my book, and I researched the German microcensus, and it is right, the birth rate is falling, but it is still much higher, and in the estimates in the now the last chapter of my book, which I called The Projections, because I don't make predictions. I mark the difference. In those estimates, I assumed, this was my estimate, that the birth rates of the immigrants already here, of the Muslim immigrants already in Germany, would fall to 2 children per woman. It's still much higher, though it is falling. Then I assumed that an additional after 100 immigrants per year would come to Germany, and from this that mixture came the dynamics. As regards the Germans in the United States, there you are right. Because of the sheer size, at the end of the 18th century, there were actually in Pennsylvania more the Germans than there were English people, and the vote whether the language of Pennsylvania should be English or German when independence started had nearly been won by the Germans. But there is one difference: the German, as well as the success of the Swedish or the Norwegian or Dutch immigrants in the United States, was always above average. The economic success, the integration in the labor market, the careers and so on, the Germans and Swedish and the Norwegian people had then the role which now have the people from Far East, whereas the success of the Italians and of the Irish was the below average, and one can still see this today. And I really think that the stable ethnic relations in the United States, I think here the word ethnic is the appropriate, between the 4 groups, the blacks, the whites, the Mexicans or those immigrants from South America, and the people from Far East, the stable relations with regard to educational and economic and scientific achievement are really interesting.
But what is absent in this statistic is the Muslim migrants in the United
States. Because they don't have a welfare state, they have no immigration from people or the other way around. Those people who go to the United States have to work in order to survive. And this is a difference from Holland and from Germany. And so they draw the selection of immigrants than we do draw.
If we come back to the point of selection of immigrants, you just stated, I know politics, so it would be better to just point out the regions where you can't have people coming in. You said, Paul Scheffer, that people, let's select migration on the grounds of education and not of how educated they are, set certain standards, and not look at their religious affiliation, though you say religious affiliation stays in the society much longer than ethnic affiliation and other ethnic affiliation. And you're saying, the the relative non-success of migrants from North Africa, for instance, is also because we selected those people on purpose to be lower educated. Yeah. Then Mr. Sarrazin said, yes, but the coolies were selected for the same reason and did better, which you said as yeah. a sort of an yeah. answer to that problem. How would you react to that, to the response of Mr. Sarrazin about those immigrants who were very badly educated and did very well?
Yeah, as I said, I think there are differences also pertaining to a culture of learning. To the extent that it's related to religion, one could argue, and Jaap Dronkers is in the audience here, who argues that the scores of pupils of with a Muslim background, but he should correct me if I'm wrong, tend to be lower. And of course, that asks the interesting question, has it something to do with attitudes towards learning and a general idea about the virtues and the place of knowledge? The contrary is, I think, absolutely evident that in Asian communities and also in the Jewish tradition, there's a strong emphasis on the virtues of learning. So you could say those cultural differences are there. But then I would maintain that you see problems of educational achievement in very different groups. In the Antillians, nothing to do with religion, with a troublesome post-colonial or still half-colonial history. With the Mexicans, I maintain that there are deep worries about generational mobility among the Mexicans, etc. So my conclusion would be, yes, there are groups that are doing better, others doing less, but I would look, and I think that is our great failure when I look at the history of the guest workers, that first of all, they were deemed not to be migrants, but passers-by in their own view and in the view of the receiving society. So we didn't have a migration policy. It was a sort of temporary labor scheme which turned out into the result we all know. And therefore, there was no consistent idea about the long-term qualifications that we needed, and also no long-term vision as to what the consequences were of having a lowly qualified first generation, which would, of course, to some extent, translate itself, those low qualifications, into their children, into the school achievements of the children. There's nothing very difficult to understand there, generally speaking. That is our great mistake. So I would do what Canada, Australia, United States, to some extent, far less than the first two countries I mentioned, that is an insistence on qualifications and simply have a far more transparent relations between the needs of the labor market, also the long-term consequences of migration, and the migrants you would like to attract. And then if a doctor comes from Ghana or Indonesia or Pakistan or elsewhere, I would not be that much interested. I have much more faith, I think, in the end, in the capacity to assimilate of our liberal societies, to the extent that I understand the defensive reactions in part of the Muslim communities. Why are they so defensive? Because they see, and that is what mothers tell me, I'm losing my child to this society. They see how their children, to some extent, and the children of their children perhaps in a greater extent, are drawn into the mainstream in many ways. And of course, they resist. There's a lot of problematic, and I don't say it's an easy story. I'm the last one to say that. But I've become, in the last 10 years, I must say, generally when looking, especially at migration history, somewhat more prone to emphasize, let's say, the generational dynamic at work, and to insist less on the nexus between especially religion and socioeconomic performance, which seems to me not that clear-cut at all, and to see the problem of Islam in our societies far more as a cultural challenge, in the sense of what is the place of religion, that was all people who came from societies where it was a majority religion or had a quasi-monopoly on spiritual life and now have to reinvent themselves as a minority in an open society. I think that is the main problem of Islam in our time.
But Mr. Sarrazin, if I read you well, and also what you said tonight, you would say that banning immigrants from those countries would mainly have to do with the fact that they are of Muslim background. Is that correct? Would you see that as the main problem for integration?
I completely agree. First, not every statistical the riddle which I see can be solved by me. Say this first. So the not ethnic relations in the United States, between the levels of the achievements are quite stable, and they are still somewhat mysterious to me. On the one hand, on the other hand, it's really astonishing if one compares PISA scores internationally. So the PISA score on the mathematics, which is where the people from the Far East do the normally the very well. The PISA score in mathematics for Indians and the Chinese also is for the children from immigrants, whether they are first or second or third generation, whatever, about 2 to 3 the school years better. Mm-hmm. For the children from Far East than for the white children, for the average white child or student. On the other hand, for the students who come from Turkey, Egypt, the Morocco, Pakistan, there are the school years the lowest, so that's the gap between students from Far East and students with origin from the Muslim countries is about 4 to 5 the school years, which is an abyss. So now it's an interesting thing. Take Pakistan. The people of Pakistan, of North Pakistan at least, are ethnically identical with the people from the northern Indian. They are both Aryans of the Persian origin, descendants of immigrants 2,000 years ago. They have the same the language, Urdi. They have the same meals, the same kind of food. But still, the students from the Pakistan score exactly as bad as students from Bangladesh or students from Turkey or from Morocco, while the students from India, which are Hindus, score much better, more like the Chinese. And we can see this in the United Kingdom, where the first generation from people from Pakistan and India came to the country in the 50s.
So this proves the
difference in the achievement between Pakistanis, yes, and Indians cannot be ethnic. It has to be cultural.
But it would be interesting to compare, because India is of course one of the largest Muslim societies as well. Uh-huh. There's over 120 million Muslims. Mm-hmm. It would be very interesting, of course, to compare the scores of those Indians with a Muslim
Indian
background
schools.
And with a Hindu background.
They go to Indian schools and not to Pakistani schools. It's a difference also.
Yeah.
I think it is a difference between Muslim culture and Hindu culture. That's the
but you yourself were saying that with the exact exemption of Iran. Well, Iran tends to be rather Islamic. So there you that would point in another direction.
That's interesting. People who came from the Iran and live now in Germany are mostly they fled the countries at the end of the 70s or in the 80s, and this is a group which is in the opposition to the Mullah regime, and so they are not very also truthful to the face on the
they're the most more, they're the more secular part of the population.
This is a different group culturally. Yeah,
I would broadly agree when you would compare. I mean, the Human Development Index of the United Nations clearly suggests this. If you compare the Muslim world in terms of educational achievement or prosperity, et cetera, or relation between men and women, there's a whole array of criteria. It always ends last of the great religions or civilizational groups that are distinguished in that sort of analysis. The question is, of course, to what extent do migrants from these countries, who have perhaps a weaker point of departure, to what extent is a society like ours, an educational system like ours, able to stimulate social mobility also in that group, those groups? And then I would say, we still live in a very unique experience because very few historical examples are of Muslim communities living in a sort of liberal democracy. It's historically also within the Muslim world, it's quite a new experience. And for me, the verdict is really open to the extent that those groups culturally will be able to find a relation between their beliefs and living in a liberal democracy, and to what extent the offspring and the offspring of their offspring will somehow be part of the mainstream, socioeconomically speaking. I think, and then of course there was a sort of diversion in your argument, speaking about the Muslim community, still 4 million people in the United States, then you were saying, yes, but that's due to the workings of the welfare state. That is an entirely different
argument. Mostly from
I would
Persia.
Agree far more
they're
on
mostly
that point.
From Persia.
Yeah.
So,
No, definitely not. There are quite a few, quite a lot of people from Lebanon, other parts of the, also from Morocco, quite a few migrants from Morocco in the United States. So it's, and then of course it becomes a bit complicated, the argument, because they tend to be more middle class. The educational achievement is above the achievement of Mexicans on the whole. And I would say, yes, the workings of the welfare state definitely do play a role, but that should be also part of our discussion. To what extent does the welfare state demobilize? We have made out of the most risk-prone part of our population, immigrants, the most dependent part of our population. That is also part of the story. It is absolutely unique in the history of migration that so many migrants are unemployed. And I'm not sure they came to hang in the mat of the welfare state and to rest there. I think most of them don't take the risk of leaving everything behind to idle at home in Neukölln or in Slotervaart. No, I think most of them did come to work. And we all know what happened with the immigration stop in 73, oil crisis, and how many were laid off, and how we misused our disability schemes to lay off people. So in that sense, the workings of the welfare state are, I think, as two older social democrats, we could agree there, that the workings of the welfare state are to blame as well.
Before I open up the floor to questions, maybe you a response?
We have the growing Arab population in Berlin, which mostly were not the refugees from the Lebanon war. Part of them with the falsified passports by way of treason, but whatever. These the families have been there now for the 35 years, and they have never had not a working history to speak of.
No.
And of course, who should blame them if they are living in Neukölln with the usual 5 to 7 children in these families? They draw the welfare and family the allowances of around the 3,000 or 4,000 euro the month, and of course, those people also work. They work on the black market, they work as taxi drivers, and so on. So they even have additional income, and they come from countries where one is well, not very well off if one is employed at all, and if this the job where one is employed in brings about 300 euro per month. So we offer them the paradise, and why shouldn't they accept paradise? I won't blame that for that. But the problem is, those of them who are able and the motivated and integrate well, they have got all the opportunities, and they will, of course, have to leave Donaukölln or may even go back to their countries, to their home countries, but the other ones will stay. And they will continue to draw additional immigrants from those countries. So there is an influx, and the better ones are educated by our system, and someday they may they leave the country, and the other ones stay, and so it's going on.
But one small remark. I mean, the main flows of migration, as they are now, are very different from 30 years ago. I mean, where 30 years ago, migration from the south dominated to a large extent, it's now migration from the east that dominates. To a certain extent, we are fighting also with the results and the echo of a past of the guest workers and the whole history of that. And to that extent, we are now much more. In the Netherlands, for example, the recent migration flows are definitely primarily Polish, etc. And with quite often the same sort of worries and discussions, but that's another question.
But it's
definitely changed.
Yes, but this is not the case in Germany. No. On the one, this is one point, and on the other is immigrants from the Russia or from Poland, mostly speak the pretty well or sufficiently well the German after some time in Germany, and they are not even noticed as immigrants. The average Polish or Russian inhabitant in Berlin is not regarded as immigrant in the sense of the word, because they work, they master the language, they are the children do above average in school, parents are generally very, very ambitious. So if they are there, they are hardly noticed. Of course, there's a Russian mafia. This is another question. They are trading in diamonds and so on. But they also take care of themselves.
If you,
in
all senses, in all senses of the word,
they
take care of themselves in all senses of the word. But if you seem to agree on one thing, that migration is not a solution to an aging population of Europe. You seem to agree on other things as well, but just to pick out this one, you seem to disagree about a few things as well. But to pick out this one, migration is not a solution to the aging population of Europe. If you, and just a very short answer to that, and I open up the debate to the floor, but if you would pick, if you had to pick or had to do one rule for how to go about with migration in Europe, as the EU, let's put it like that, if you would say, well, to look forward into the next 2 decades or something, if you had to introduce one rule for migration, what would it be, both of you? What sort of rule, how to go about with migration? As you well pointed out, there will be migration. There's a big migration explosion in the rest of the world. We are aging. So how to go about with that? What would be the one rule you would introduce, Mr. Sarrazin and Mr. Scheffer?
Then no immigration from Africa and from Near and Middle East, no immigration at all. We are much better off as a aging society, if we take care of ourselves, then we have to work on the average until we are 75, and those between 75 and 85 have to take care of those who are above 85, but it will somehow work. And so, and we are much better off in this kind of world, which is not a pretty one, than when we have the additional the problem of migration from Africa and Near and Middle East.
So you're saying both pictures are bleak, but the one is less bleak than the other, actually.
Pardon?
You're saying both pictures of the future are bleak, are not very beautiful, but the one is less problematic than the other.
Well, well, not the life goes on anyway.
Mr. Scheffer?
I would do basically very simple things. First of all, really become worried about the future of the second generation in our larger metropolitan areas. Substantial unemployment in the French banlieues reaching 50%, above 50%, but also in some areas in Amsterdam, 30% or more. So that is the first thing. Second thing, I would look far more closely at migration flows within Europe. Because I can see now the emergence of some of the same problems of people living here with the expectation of going back, but my prediction would be that at least half of the Polish immigrants in Britain, in the Netherlands, will stay, will have children here, and when the children are born, typically the way back home becomes further and further and longer and longer. So a substantial part of East European migrants will stay here. We will be faced with this serious problem of the Roma.
Yes, that's right.
That is not something we talk about much, but I think when we look at the situation in which they're living, 12 million people in Eastern Europe, they will become more mobile, as we've seen in Italy and France already. That will pose some serious problems. And then I would be, for migration outside of Europe, I would be very restrictive and basically focus on the sort of qualifications we need. For example, student exchanges, people high level in IT, in the entertainment business, etc., etc. A lot of areas where people from all walks of life, from all parts of the world, are coming and could contribute substantially. I would look at those three elements, those who are already here, those who move within Europe, and be very restrictive towards those from outside of Europe, because I think we have serious problems in employing those who are already here or who are moving freely in a Europe without borders. I think we should devote our primary energy to those.
Thank you very much, both of you. Yes, here, over here.
My name is André van Delft. I have a question. There is a worldwide big correlation between presence of Islam and misery. Never has, in history, has Muslim immigration brought prosperity. Never has a country benefited of it in a positive way. Many people here in Holland are very unhappy with it. Many people are victim of crime related, caused by Muslim immigrants. Many people feel threatened above all in their freedom of expression.
And what's the question?
And the question is, why would we not just stop Muslim immigration?
And you would like to point it to both or to?
First to Mr. Scheffer, because he doesn't see a very big problem, I think. And then the reaction by Mr. Sarrazin, please.
Thanks.
So the basic idea is when somebody from India, who is a specialist in IT, the first question you would ask him, please tell me what your religious affiliation is. If you're a Muslim, sorry. If you're a Hindu, please, welcome. I sort of find that in deep contradiction with our constitution, with the basic idea of personal freedom and freedom of religion. So I would abhor a society that would judge people by those standards. I think the United States, not by religion, although the Catholic immigrants from Poland, Italy, and Ireland were definitely for a long period not welcome in Protestant America. There wasn't 1924, there were ethnic criteria to sort of preserve the ethnic balance in America to keep out the migrants, specifically from Italy and the Balkans, which were described as inferior races in the most bleak terms. Not very successful, this legislation, but I don't think that beyond asking really in a serious way what is the sort of qualifications we need, because we talk about labor migration and the first worry should be what is the qualifications migrants can bring to our labor market. And then of course we have the question of refugees, which is primarily a humanitarian question, and there as well I guess you wouldn't like to make the separation. If you're a refugee with a Muslim belief, you're not welcome. If you're persecuted, if you have a different religion, you're welcome. So I don't think it is at all feasible in a liberal democracy to have that sort of immigration policy.
Mr. Sarrazin, no, Mr. Sarrazin.
No.
Hey.
No.
I will not allow this sort of shouting, and I will not allow...
That's a pity.
Yeah, but I will not. So no. We're having a decent conversation, and...
I agree with Paul Schäfer. It is not feasible to select immigrants according to religion, and it would not be in accordance with the European tradition. Therefore, I have a different solution: no immigrants from Africa, Near and Middle East.
I have another question here.
During his final remarks...
With regard for the occasional engineer, with the exception of the occasional engineer from Egypt, he is, of course, welcome.
Oh, he's welcome.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. And the doctors from Ghana in the National Health Service.
Well, I am
60% of Ghanaese doctors are working in the West.
I am friends with a doctor from Ghana and his two and he
can come.
He has
well.
Got about okay. 11 brothers and several of them work in the United Kingdom and in Germany, and to put it bluntly, 80%. Of all doctors which went to school in Ghana are working outside of Ghana. Yeah. So we should really ask if we act responsibly, if we attract about 80% of the qualified people from Africa.
Okay,
that's a very different argument.
Yeah.
I have a bunch of other questions. Arguments. We will not be able to have everybody joining in, but another question.
During his last remarks, Paul Schäfer mentioned the open borders within the EU. Of course, this is one of the largest questions that we haven't properly addressed so far. It's pretty impossible for countries within the European Union to have a restrictive immigration policy due to those open borders. Wouldn't it be an implication of both of your recommendation to have restrictive immigration to abolish the open borders idea behind the European Union? Shouldn't we get rid of that philosophy?
In order to be able to get the rest of the world in, or what?
In order to be able to actually have a restrictive immigration policy. You can't have a restrictive immigration policy with the present EU. It's impossible.
Would you agree to that? Or?
Well, the open borders policy, the Schengen Treaty, is a core element of the European the Union, and I would be cautious to abolish it. But of course. The certain conditions have to be fulfilled. If the Italians and the Spanish and the Greek people are not able to effectively to control their borders, then in the end we might have no choice but to look of this to this kind of policy. If one visits Naples or Pisa, and then one sees there the number of the refugees from Northern Africa, it's really a matter of concern. I think, in the long term, the open borders policy will only be feasible if the external borders are effectively closed.
Okay, Mr. Schaffer.
Well, it depends, of course, what you see as the main problem, the movement of people within the European Union, or the inability, as you suggest, of the European Union to defend its external borders. Let's presume it's about the last question, not so much about Polish migration or Hungarian migration, then I would agree. I mean, one of the big problems, and that is why I think the European Union has become so vulnerable, because it doesn't offer protection. It has created a large area of free movement, but this freedom has caused a problem of security at the external border. So if you want to have open borders, you need to have far more of an engagement at the common external border. But we don't understand that Europe is about making foreign policy into domestic policy. So Berlusconi has become our politician. The Greek deficit has become our deficit. But also the Spanish illegal migrants are the future citizens, probably, or possibly, of the Netherlands and Germany. So in that sense, you need in a space of open borders, you need far more engagement. But that's no fatality. It's simply a political choice not to do as much as could have been done. There was a proposal by Aznar and Blair to do much more about illegal migration in the European Union, and it was vetoed by the French president at the time. I think it was Chirac at the time, and by Helmut Kohl. So it is not a political fatality. It's simply a question of asking oneself, if we really want this free movement of area, this area of free movement, what are the preconditions to make it stable? And I think you asked exactly the right question there.
Thank you.
You hold the microphone. Sorry, I'm a journalist, so I always try to get the microphone. Thank you very much for the discussion. As Yuri already mentioned, I'm a filmmaker from Germany. I made a film about a Palestinian refugee family. It would be very interesting for you, Mr. Sarrazin, to see the film if you're here, because I followed the family for 5 years. Let me start with the facts. Both of you mentioned that migration is not a solution of the problems of Europe. I would agree, but this is a sentence which makes no sense at all, because migration is a fact in Europe and always has been. We always had migration in Europe. Maybe it's even one of the reasons Europe exists, as just king, because I see your skepticism in your eyes, Mr. Schaffer. The Prussian king, Frederick II, in 1749, had some demographic problems and needed some workers from abroad, and he asked the Turks to come and said, if the Turks will come to help us, we will build their mosques just that they work and live with us. And as far as I know, Europe still exists since that time.
So migration is here anyway. You mean it's here to stay?
It's here to stay, yeah. And of course, that's not a solution, but the sky is blue, and that's not a solution of Europe if the sky would
but
be
that
green.
Is exactly,
so, I mean, that's,
that is exactly why it has become such a contentious issue, because it has become linked in the mind of people with being beyond control. And I think all evidence of migration history shows that it's not beyond control. There is hardly any substantial migration flow without interference of governments, either governments through civil war or conflict that push their citizens outside of their borders, or governments, like the scheme of the guest workers, but I could quote many, many other examples throughout history, that have actively encouraged migrants to come. So the whole idea, and that it's the same fantasy as about globalization, it's somehow beyond our reach, whereas globalization of the financial markets, for example, has been a conscious decision of institutions to abolish rules or to create new rules, etc. So I think the whole migration regime as such is far more a subject of political decision making as is commonly understood, and the whole idea that we live in a world without borders is simply not true. If you look at attempts in the Netherlands, for example, to curb family reunification, have been largely successful. If you look at Germany, the laws after the heated debate in 92 on asylum, you've seen a decrease of asylum from more than almost 500,000 yearly to 1/5 of it. So don't tell me that migration is beyond political decision making. It simply isn't true. It is beyond, for some, beyond the willingness to do something.
But the point you were, okay, you didn't, you weren't making, but the point you were making, sorry?
That's right. I absolutely agree, but I doubt that, you know, you shouldn't talk about migration as a solution or not, because we have migration as well from refugees as from guest workers. The thing is, you were talking about what migration will do. That's the whole topic of your book, Deutschland schafft sich ab. How migration, especially the migration of Muslim people, as you said, African, Arabs and Turks, how they will inflect the development of Germany. And I did some research as well, and it's not so complicated in times of the internet, so I have some numbers from the German Statistisches Bundesamt, so the official statistics. As you said, Mr. Schreffer, about the next generation. By now, 73% of the Turks living in Germany, they love to live in Germany. 68% of them say that they speak fluently German, and even I think about 84% agree on the thesis that you need the German language to have success in Germany. Even the thesis of Mr. Sarrazin that people with migrant background are not real. You don't need them for any economic reason.
The question.
Excuse me. The question is how does these numbers deal with your book, Mr. Sarrazin? Because you know.
Well, all the numbers.
You mean they are very successful? That's what you mean.
They're very successful.
All the figures in my book are the correct. And they are mostly drawn from the Statistisches Bundesamt, and with regard to Paul's from the Turkish people in Germany, you may read the foreword to my book in the paperback, and there I quoted a poll from a Berlin Institute which makes the marketing between the Turkish people there in Germany, and there it was that the majority of Turkish people in Germany has not contact with Germans in their the free time and does not want to have contact, that more than half of them has not a good command of the German language, and that the 40% would immediately have to return to the Turkey if they didn't get the welfare anymore. And the 20% hoped that someday the majority in that the Germany might be the Muslim and they the welcome that. This is the actual poll by Turkish Marketing Institute in Berlin.
I think we have time for maybe two more questions. That's about it, I would say. Yes, over here.
Good evening, sirs. My name is Samuel van Steen. I've lived in Athens for quite a while. My question is about you've spoken a lot about the outer borders of the European Union, immigration from Eastern Europe and Africa. Well, 82%, I'm currently writing my thesis about the immigration in Greece and in Athens. 82% goes through Greece. Greece has 1,600 islands, and 82% of all the immigrants usually come from Africa, some come from Asia, and they immigrate into the European Union via Greece. Premier Blair was also, former Prime Minister Blair was also mentioned, and he also had an idea of external processing, meaning that all European countries should basically post some sort of embassy or a refugee camp somewhere in Greece and then try to process all these immigrants. What is your stance about this?
Good new industry for Greece, sounds like. But
as I said before, an open border policy that within Europe can only work in the long run if the borders not against the rest of the world are effectively controlled. And that is not the case right now. And the problem is unsolved. And the, and as Paul Schäfer said, the European authorities seem not to be determined to solve this problem, or the other way around. They seem to be determined not to solve this problem. And this is a problem.
Paul, do you have anything to add to that? No?
No.
Then I have, I have the last question over here.
Good evening. I'm Musab. I'm a student. And my question goes out to Saracen, but first I would like to add a comment. I totally agree with the numbers that were shown in Germany about the Turkish people who don't know the language, the German language, that well. This problem also occurs in Holland. But what we see most of the time is that recent studies have shown that Turkey is now largely growing economically. You should know that as an economist. And most of the people here who study here are migrating back to Turkey and they're building their own country and they're making sure that the economy grows that way. How would you describe that?
Well, if the students in the Netherlands or in the Germany, they return to the home country and help build up this country, I think that's a good thing. I don't think it's a problem that some people of Turkish or Arab origin not to choose to return. I think that the problem is that those who are not successful not to choose to stay here.
Paul?
Well, I often hear, you know, that the arguments of going back to Turkey, although the word back here is somewhat strange, because quite often it's about people who were born in the Netherlands. But of course, it's often suggested that the difficult climate in the Netherlands somehow provokes them into leaving. I tend to think that there is far more positive side there, that it's the attraction of the booming economy of Turkey. Of course, the interesting question will be how far this economic development in Turkey will go. But it's definitely contradicts a somewhat stable idea, you know, that the Muslim communities are somehow stuck in their place in the world and somehow cannot escape an historical fate that has been with them for centuries. I tend to think that Turkey, for example, could be an example of a society developing into a society with a large middle class, like other societies. I think corruption might be a huge problem, perhaps even a bigger problem than having a Muslim majority population in the sense of economic development. I think it would be interesting to look also at the Muslim communities of India as an example. It would be interesting to look at middle classes in Indonesia. I think if we look at emerging economies also in part of the Muslim world, we need to relativize the somewhat fatalistic, historically informed arguments about, you know, the place of people, the place of religions in the wider world. I think there's much more change, much more dynamic, much more things which we would have never thought that would be possible. And therefore, I tend to think that the presence of Muslim communities in Europe, 20 million now perhaps, is not only, you know, a unique historic experience, but I think that the chances of being truthful to the idea of religious freedom and having an open society which really offers a possibility for those who want to do something with their lives, and having a reformed welfare state that not hampers people but offers a possibility, I think that would be far more of an attraction of Europe in the world than a society that would say no to migrants from the Middle East, of the Arab world, or Africa, because I don't think that that sort of ethnic criteria or religious criteria in the end will help Europe to be what it claims to be.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Herr Sarrazin, Meneer Scheffer. Thank you very much for being here. It has been over two hours. Thank you very much for your patience bearing with us. I'd like to show you a few minutes of a trailer about the movie, about the problems immigrants face, we're showing tomorrow evening. The first 50 people with their ticket can take a free ticket for tomorrow evening. I'd like to show you the trailer. I'd like to thank you very much for coming here, both of you, and I'm very proud that we staged the first public event of Mr. Sarrazin in the Netherlands, and I'm very proud about the fact that we had such a long and good and intense discussion on these difficult problems. Thank you very much.
Hier bei uns gibt es so ein Spiel. Das spielen wir jedes Wochenende mit 30, 40, manchmal auch 50 Jungs. Der gekriegt wird, kriegt 30 Sekunden lang Todesschläge und darf sich nicht mal wehren. Einer bleibt übrig, der einfach der Beste von allen ist, den sie nicht gekriegt haben. Und das ist dann der Gangsterläufer.
Ja, ich habe so ziemlich einer der größten Namen, die es überhaupt hier gibt. Ich gehöre zu den ersten 10 von Neukölln.
Oh, Scheiße! Auf einmal ruft mein Cousin mich an und kommt mit so einer Sache. Er sagt, eine 500.000. 600.000 Euro soll da drin sein. Ich habe das wieder gehabt, ich habe wieder dieses... Diese Energie, diese kriminelle Energie gehabt in mir. Ich habe das wieder gefühlt und ich konnte einfach nicht widerstehen. Ich habe sofort dahin gefahren und habe angefangen, die Sache zu planen. Und dann ist alles kaputt gegangen. Keine 500.000 war drin und wir wurden gekriegt.
Nicht so, ich will nicht mit der U-Bahn fahren. Ist peinlich, was soll ich mit der U-Bahn fahren? Die ganzen Leute gucken mich an, niemals.
12 Stunden, du sagst so. In deiner Zelle. Knast, ja? Ist nicht hart. Ist nicht mal ein bisschen hart, ja? Aber diese Langeweile bringt dich um. Nur diese Langeweile. Wenn ich einen Fernseher in meiner Zelle hätte, sollen die mich 5 Jahre einsperren.
Ich weiß nicht, warum meine Kinder immer will Scheiß machen. Ich möchte meinen Kindern nicht nach Knast gehen. Ist egal, keine andere Strafe, aber nicht Knast von das alt. Weißt du, die Knast gibt es schlechte Leute drin.
Ich habe schon 1 Jahr und 3 Monate gewartet. Mehr kann ich gar nicht. Ich bin schon 9 geworden. Er hat meinen Geburtstag nicht er hat mich nicht gesehen.
Einer, glaube ich. Herzlich willkommen hier heute Abend in der Bali. Mein Name ist Juri Albrecht, ich bin der Direktor der Bali. Wir sind ganz froh, dass Herr Sarrazin aus Berlin hierher gekommen ist. Ich würde den Rest des Abends auf Englisch reden, weil wir die Debatte auf Englisch halten, aber ich möchte gerne herzlich willkommen sagen, Herr Sarrazin und Herr Stahl. Beides hier in Holland, in Amsterdam. Very happy to have you here all. We have an interesting debate tonight, I would say. We're very happy to have Thilo Sarrazin and Paul Scheffer to have a debate on migration, on Europe, on Germany. I would introduce the two speakers to you. But first I'd like to say, switch off your mobile phones. I mean, I don't mean switch them off, but you can easily use Twitter, but don't make them ring. We organized this debate also thanks to Katharina Rinsema and Christian Stahl in Berlin and Rinsema here in the Bali. This is the first time Herr Sarrazin speaks in Holland, which is actually quite amazing because he's a prolific writer and controversial writer in Germany. And since we are a debating center, we thought it might be a good idea to bring the controversy here to Amsterdam. Paul Scheffer and Thilo Sarrazin will be speaking on migration, which is a hotly debated topic for the last decade at least. Thilo Sarrazin is a German politician for the SPD, former member of the executive board of the Deutsche Bundesbank. He was a senator of finance in the state of Berlin. That would be something like an alderman, I would suppose, here in Holland. And he wrote over 15 books. He wrote in 2010, Deutschland schafft sich ab, one of the most popular books on politics in the German language in a decade. More than 1.5 million copies were sold. And he wrote this year another book, Germany braucht den Euro nicht. And the book argues that introduction of a single currency in Europe in the form of the euro was a bad idea and should be overturned. He wrote actually more books on it. In 1997 already, Der Euro, Chance oder Abenteuer. Und dann im 98, in 1998, all those languages. Anyway, Der Euro. The book Deutschland schafft sich ab, das war also wirklich umstritten. Die SPD hat versucht, ja, da bin ich wieder auf Deutsch. Ja. The German Labour Party tried to chuck him out, actually, to sort of say it colloquially, but in the end decided not to suspend his membership. Paul Scheffer, I don't need to introduce him for this audience, I would say, very long. He's, of course, a well-known journalist and writer in our country. He's also a well-known professor. He's professor in the Wieboud Leerstuhl an der UvA. He was for almost 10 years. And he is now, for more than a year, professor in European Studies in the University of Tilburg, writing on a very interesting topic on the outsiders looking in on Europe, which is expected. The book, I don't know, in about a year time, I hope. He is the writer of The Multiculturele Drama in 2000, an essay for the NRC Handelsblad, which has been quoted over and over again. And he's, among other books, he wrote Een tevreden natie, Nederland en het wederkerend geloof in de Europese status quo. I'm not trying to translate that in any language. Anyway, het land van aankomst, the land of destination, I would say, but it's translated differently, I think, the title in English. But immigrant nations, I wouldn't have thought about that. I would know. Het land van aankomst. So we're happy that the two of you are here and are willing to talk about the issues of migration. And I'm very happy that Christian Stahl helped us to organize this. He's a documentary maker in Berlin. His documentary will be shown tomorrow evening here, and with your card, you can actually go there with the card you bought tonight to see it. It's a splendid documentary about multiculturalism, the drama of the integration, I would say, actually, integration in the German situation. Okay, I'd like to give the floor to Mr. Thilo Sarrazin. Please, Mr. Sarrazin.
Arthur, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. During the most part of my professional career, I was an economist. I started out as an economist, but I soon became a civil servant in the Ministry of Finance in Germany. And I must say, I was, for the most part of my professional life, both the dedicated economist and dedicated civil servant. It was only in the late stage of my the career that I took the political office. I have always tried to understand the driving forces behind the development of economies, of societies, and of peoples. And so I have, as an amateur, I must say, taken interest in history, in the political philosophy, and in the emergence and the decline of peoples and of cultures. I say as an amateur, because as a professional, I'm an economist and a civil servant. My interest in the demographic, the questions, started in 1972, when I dealt for the first time with the long term, the consequences of the steep fall of the birth rate in Germany. This fall of the German birth rate started in 1965. In only 5 years at that time, the reproduction rate, this is the number of children per woman, fell from the post-war level of 2 children to 1.4 children. And this, the level has been stable for the last 45 years. As a result, the absolute number of births in Germany fell from the 1.4 million in 1965 to the 663,000 in 2011. If this trend goes on, one can exactly calculate the time when the Germany will be the smaller than Holland, at least as regards the people. For a long time, the stability of this trend was denied in most German discussions. First, this won't go on. Then this is not so bad. We are so many anyway, and so on. But when this could not be denied anymore, then it's the long-term implications for the economy and for the society were played down. At the beginning, this was quite easy, because it takes 30 years for the generation to grow up and to enter the labor market. As in most Western countries, the post-war boom and the growing scarcity of cheap labor had caused an influx of the migrant workers, mostly from European countries, but later on more and more from Turkey, the Africa, and the Near Middle East. The number of the asylum seekers grew as well, and the attractiveness of the German welfare system did the rest. I think this has been pretty much the same story in most countries of the Northern and Western Europe. Since the 80s, the German discussions of the demography on the one hand and the migration on the other hand, they were more and more mixed up. Migration was presented as the solution for the looming demographic gap. This gap could not be denied anymore, because the trend had then already been going on for the 25 years. And so the issue of the migration was welcome for playing down the consequences of the low birth rate. The idea or the ideology of the multiculturalism also played a role. Since the World War II, many mainstream thinkers in the German media and in the humanities were ill at ease with the fact that they were doomed to live in Germany as Germans. They hoped that the German people, the German country, and the German culture would dissolve into something bigger and better, that the German ugly duck, as they conceived themselves, would emerge as the European swan. This was the new expression for the longing for the Weltgeist, as described in Hegel's The Philosophy. The Weltgeist is something that gives sense and the purpose to the course of history. The Weltgeist also drove communism. This attitude of the Weltgeist nourished both the German enthusiasm for the unified Europe and the hoped for the emergence of the multicultural society in Europe. Those who expressed the skepticism tended to be the ridiculed as backward and the provincial, if not worse. Time and again, there occurred discussions about the integration of immigrants, which pointed at certain problems, but normally those discussions died away quickly. See, the German policy on migration and integration has always treated and is still treating immigrants and foreigners as the uniform group. It has been the official policy to deny or play down the influence of ethnic, cultural, and the religious issues, the backgrounds of migrants and of their offspring. Only the role of the Islam and the influence of the radical Islamic thinking on some groups were taken more seriously since the end of the 90s, not especially since 9/11. Myself, I used to have a very pragmatic view on migration. My thinking was that of the economist. It was quite clear to me that the demographic problems could not be solved and hardly be alleviated with any kind of the migration, for the simple reasons that babies don't immigrate. Only gradually did the role of ethnic, cultural, and the religious differences dawn on me. I am married, I was married, and I still am married to a teacher. And since the early 70s, a number of our friends have been teachers, but for a long time I regarded the evidence that I got from them as mainly the anecdotal. Only when I became the senator of finance in the state of the Berlin, I began to concern myself with the statistical evidence and the research on the background of immigrants, as well as the speed and success, or in some cases, the lack of speed of success of the integration in the labor market and in the society, because this was a big driver for the public expenditure in Berlin, and so for the deficit. The evidence was crushing. Immigrants from Eastern Europe, from Southern Europe, with the slight exception of maybe Southern Italy, from India and from the Far East, integrate in Berlin and all over the Germany, the generally very well. And the second generation, most indicators for these the groups of immigrants are favorable. Especially descendants from immigrants from the Far East do also in the Germany, they're much better in school and in the labor markets than the Germans themselves. This part of the statistical picture in Germany resembles the evidence in the United States, in Canada, Australia, and in the UK. The bulk of problems with integration in the first generations and virtually all the problems in the second generations of immigrants and in later generations are connected with the migrants from Turkey, Africa, the Near Middle East, with the exception of migrants from Iran and the migrants with the Christian faith. They have somewhat different and better indicators. These are the groups with the highest birth rates, with the lowest labor market integration, with the lowest educational performance, with the highest dependency on the welfare, and with the highest criminality, same as in the Netherlands. Of course, the performance of these groups is not uniform. They also that are also the produce achievers, but taken all in all, that the results are disturbing and the progress is slow, even in the third and in the fourth degeneration of these immigrants. Together with the low German birth rate, this constitutes the structural problem that which is getting worse over time. The general shift in the socio-economic structure of the families of the newly born in Germany aggravates the problem further. The better educated and the brighter the parents, the fewer the babies, and vice versa. In my book, Deutschland schafft sich ab, I took an integrated approach to questions of the demography, of education, of the structure, organization of the welfare system, of the labor market, of culture, the religion, immigration, and integration, and analyzed the long-term consequences for the German future. The outlook was disturbing, and this was reflected in the public discussions, which was heated and the controversial. I did not make a prediction in my book, because one can never predict the future. At the utmost, one can shed light. One can shed some light on evident risks and on the likely developments, and this was what I did. Taken all in all, the emotional, the character of the public reaction to my book, either hostile or enthusiastic, that surprised me, and it somehow shocked me. But the emotions are not always a bad thing. In politics as well as generally in life, nothing ever changes, nothing ever is the getting done without the driving force of the human will. That the human will that uses the tools of rational reasoning for its ends, but the source of its strength and of its direction is always emotional. Early in the preparation of my book, at the beginning of 2009, I came across Paul Schäffer's name and I read the German translation of Het Land van Ankomst, which is called in German Die Eingewanderten, der Toleranz in einer grenzenlosen Welt. The subtitle seems to be coming from the lector of the book, which obviously wanted to give it the somewhat more the positive touch than it actually had. Whatever. The German translation was published in 2007. I was fascinated by this work. It greatly influenced my book. It directed my thinking, and it influenced many of the questions with which I confronted the German situation. Of course, the scope of both books is different with regard to historical, the sociological and cultural aspects of immigration and integration. Paul Schäffer's book digs much deeper. In my book, I have the broader focus on the future of the German society and its driving forces, between which the structure of the future immigration and the policy of it play an important role. In my concluding remarks, I address the matters of immigration and integration with regard to the future in Europe. The Europe as a whole, however you define it, you have the choice. The Eurozone, the EU, the whole of Europe, including Russia, however you define it, the Europe as a whole is aging and its population is dwindling due to low birth rates. In those countries where the birth rates are still near or somewhat above the reproduction level, the higher birth rates of the Muslim immigrants plays an important role for this statistical outcome. It can easily be shown that the further immigration from Africa near and Middle East produces more cost financially and economically, as well as in terms of the social and of cultural tensions, than it produces benefits in moral, financial, and economic terms. At the same time, further migration to Europe does not solve the problems in those regions where the migrants come from. And these the problems are high population growth, backward economies, weak institutions. In the 1900, 110 years ago, the whole of Africa had a population from the 133 million people, a third of the population of Europe. Presently, Africa has a population of the 1 billion, the 22 million people, which is the 40% more than the whole of Europe from the Gibraltar to the Ural. And in the next 90 years, until 2100, the population in the Africa will more than triple to the 3.6 billion people, then more than five times the size of the population of Europe. These numbers are from the new population estimate of the United Nations. These estimates are generally pretty accurate. In 1950, the United the Nations predicted exactly the size of the world population in the year 2000. If only a small part of this the population grows, the migrates to Europe, the sheer number is the problem for the European tradition, for the European way of life, and for the European economic standards, without really helping the regions they come from, because which is a trickle for them is a broad stream for us. In view of this perspective, there's a sensible course that for Europe is undoubtedly to prevent further immigration from Africa, the Near and Middle East. At the same time, the integration and assimilation of all immigrants in Europe, which are already legally here, should of course be intensified and accelerated. In this regard, we have to be true to our culture and tradition. Although this double approach stop for the further immigration from Africa, Near Middle East, integration and assimilation of those who are already here is the sensible, it is not the likely to occur. It's the same as with the euro. The long view interests very few people, the least of all the majority of the politicians. It's easier to muddle through and concentrate on the relieving the very next pain, and then the next, and then the next, and so on. I'm afraid this kind of that the strategic genius which the presently rules the savings of Greece will also form the future policies of immigration and integration in Europe. This means one will do too little until it is too late, and then will one say, now it is too late. For the euro, as well as for the European immigration and integration, it is tempting to predict the future course of events, and there are good reasons to paint that future in dark colors. But for today, as I already said, it's always difficult to make predictions. I will resist this temptation, and I will finish with quoting two the German poets. First, Friedrich Hölderlin from 1802. Nah ist und der schwer zu fassende Gott, wo aber Gefahr ist, wächst das Rettende auch. Yeah, very well said. And the other quote is from Friedrich Schiller. Das Alte stürzt, es ändert sich die Zeit und neues Leben blüht aus den Ruinen. Thank you very much.
Herzlichen Dank, Herr Sarrazin. Thank you very much for your introduction, for your thoughts. We've asked Paul Scheffer, who've seen your speaking notes, to react to it. And after that, we will continue the debate between the two of you. And later on, we hope that the audience will join in as well. Thank you very much, Herr Sarrazin. Paul Scheffer, to you.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to meet you here. I've, of course, followed the debate in Germany after your book was published. You say you were astonished by the emotional reactions. To some extent, I was astonished too, but I had a small preview after my own book was translated in Germany, and I went there to have quite a few debates. Of course, I felt immediately, like in the Netherlands, although to some extent for different historical reasons, that the debate was, of course, quite difficult, very charged by the shadows of history, and in many senses not easy. Of course, one of the great things about discussions across borders is that emotions don't travel easily. I mean, what happened in the Netherlands was, of course, that many of the things that were said about immigration provoked a lot of debates, but when you cross borders, of course, a more detached view is possible, and the same will happen probably here, and has happened here, because, of course, there has been quite a few articles about your book and about discussions in Germany, but largely with a far more detached view, because perhaps, and this says a lot about the possibilities of a European public sphere, that emotions are so tied to language and language communities that they don't travel easily. As for the subtitle, you're quite correct in your thinking that the subtitle of my book was not directly my first preference. My proposal was Die offene Gesellschaft und ihre Grenzen as a subtitle, The Open Society and Its Borders. But then people told me in Germany that they went to the bookshops with that subtitle and that it somehow didn't work at all, and that the word Toleranz somehow fitted general purposes of selling and buying better. I want to react basically to two of your remarks. First, on what I think is absolutely a good starting point, and that is your observations you make about demography and immigration. And I'm always astonished to the extent that demography doesn't play much of a role in public debates, definitely not in the Netherlands. But if you look at it, and I won't repeat all the figures that you gave, but if you look at the situation today in the European Union with 27 nations, roughly 500 million people. This population will reach its peak by 2040 with 226 million people and then slowly decline. Europe is the only continent today where the average birth rate is under the replacement level. So if we wouldn't have any migration, the population overall would be shrinking already. The average is now 1.6, where it should be a little bit above 2, as is easily can be understood. As of today, 20% of the growth in Europe, population growth, is excess of birth. 80% is due to immigration. If you look at the US or Canada, which is of course quite a relevant comparison, then you see that where Europe is very marginally, only with 3% in the next 40 years, the population is growing. At the same period, the population of the United States will grow with 36%, in Asia 25%, not to speak of Africa. So the share of the European population will decline further in the next decades, from a little bit above 7% as it is now, to somewhat above 5% of the world population in the next 40 years. So the first couple of questions this rough development should raise and doesn't provoke in the public debate in, across Europe is, what does it tell us about the vitality of our societies? Because it's a unique constellation historically. It's a unique constellation if we compare the European continent with other continents. What does it tell us? That we have a growing population, which is not the same as a shrinking population, but definitely in a couple of European countries, we already see populations shrinking. What does it tell us? It's a common wisdom among demographers that a bulb of young people is a cause of innovation, political reform, not to speak of revolution. So the Arab Spring is always connected in the public mind and in analysis with a relatively young population. Well, skip the relative here. I think 50% of the population of Egypt is under 16 years. So, but why wouldn't the opposite be true, that a graying and shrinking population somehow diminishes the capacity for innovation, the capacity for economic growth, and also that in a time of globalization, when the needs for adaptation and innovation are perhaps bigger than ever, a population that we are witnessing as it is developing in the coming decades is perhaps ill-suited for that circumstance? So that would be the first question to ask. Why isn't there a debate about what does it tell us that our population is graying and shrinking? A second remark on demography and immigration would be that we have to see the differences inside Europe. Germany is definitely not the example of Europe, generally speaking. There are wide differences when we look at demographic developments inside Europe. And that, of course, raises interesting questions as well. If we look at Finland, Norway, Sweden, UK, France, and Ireland, definitely not all related, as you suggested, to higher birth rates of the Muslim population. If you look at those countries which have, of course, for decades already, a policy with regard to family and with regard to gender that is not the European mainstream, we see fertility levels of 1.9 to 2.1, whereas in Germany, Italy, and Eastern Europe, or the other end of this divide with 1.2, 1.3. So the question is, of course, how can these differences be explained? Very complicated question. But it suggests, at least if we look at France, for example, which has followed already for a period just beginning after the Second World War, a policy with regard to those demographic developments, that intervention, that public debate about it matters, and that we simply shouldn't take those long-term developments as a natural given, but as an object also of inquiry and dispute. Third remark on demography and immigration is that immigration, as you said, cannot be the answer to demographic stagnation or decline. Not only because babies don't immigrate, which I found a nice way to summarize a whole library of books about this topic, but Perhaps simply given the sheer size of immigration that would be needed to keep the ratio of people under 65 and people above 65 at the level as it is now. The same United Nations Bureau of Population has calculated this. For example, for the Netherlands, the size of immigration that we would need in the next 30 years to have the demographic balance as it is now. The Netherlands would need a net immigration of 300,000 people every year, 10 times the level it is now. And then in 2050, the Netherlands would have 39 million inhabitants. The problem with this is not only that it's quite a sizable presence in a small country, but then, of course, the problem of graying reoccurs because migrants have the obnoxious tendency to become older as well. So then in 2050, the whole problem would start all over again. So politicians like to emphasize all the time that immigration is the answer to demographic decline, and it's simply not true. Immigration can be a small part of the solution, but the vast question that lies behind shrinking and graying populations is, of course, a question of retirement age, a question of reform of the welfare state, a question of productivity, and so forth, and so forth. So that is, I think, important to remark those questions about demography and immigration, because they get confused all the time if people speak about it at all. Then the second question, which of course has given perhaps provoked most debate about your book and also what you've emphasized today, and that is the relation between ethnicity and integration, especially in social economic terms. Whereas you say different migrant communities perform differently in the labor market, in the schooling system, and generally speaking, social economic integration has a clear link to ethnic, cultural, or religious differences. As you stated in your speech here, the bulk of the problems are connected with migrants from Turkey, Africa, Near and Middle East, and then you specify, with the exception of migrants from Iran and migrants with a Christian faith. So the implication is the bulk of the problems within the Muslim community, not so much ethnicity as religion. And one should differentiate, of course, as a beginning point, very clearly between the two, because history suggests that ethnicity fades over time, that ethnic affiliation becomes less and less relevant from one generation to the other, whereas religion tends to persevere in a society much longer. So the main thesis is then that religion, or the Muslim communities, generally speaking, that there the main problems concentrate in terms of labor participation, educational performance, crime, etc. Looking at the Netherlands, one could say that there is ample evidence for this idea, but I definitely want to qualify your suggestion in three ways. First, if we look at the United States today, it's definitely not the Muslim communities or migrants from the Near East or the Middle East or Morocco that are, economically speaking, in the worst situation. They tend to be more middle class than the same migrants arriving in Europe. And the main problems in socio-economic terms are with the Mexican immigrants. So that relativizes immediately, if we look at the experience of the United States, the clear nexus between religion or culture and socio-economic performance. Second remark would be looking at the history of migration, that generally speaking, there has always been a temptation to make a direct link between ethnicity and low expectations about assimilation. But that was true for the German immigrants in America. We all know what Benjamin Franklin wrote about those immigrants. He said they're trying to Germanize America. They're trying to overtake our culture. But also, if you look at the reactions to the Irish, the Italians, the Chinese of all, 65 years America had the Chinese Exclusion Act, where it was impossible for people with a Chinese background to become American citizen. Why? Because their ethnicity was deemed to be inferior. So we should keep that in mind a little bit when speaking about today's expectations and worries that almost every migrant community throughout history, the Italians in Marseille, the Polish in Germany, the Irish in Britain, et cetera, not only in America but also in Europe, were met with low expectations about the possibility of their assimilation. Thirdly, we should always keep in mind when speaking about the Muslim communities in Germany and the Netherlands, that their presence overlaps with the history of guest workers. So those were people specifically selected for their low qualifications in terms of education. I'm making, with two people who are here in the audience, a film about migration as it happened in the last 50 years. And then you see also a sequence of the way the guest workers were selected. Somebody enters the room, somebody of the Duff factory is sitting there, looking over his glasses with a penetrating view, and then the guy comes in, and the first question is, you speak French? Oui, monsieur. How many years you have in school? 8 ans, monsieur. Go away. Too many years of qualification. So we selected people with the lowest qualification, and that there is such a strong overlap between that history and the presence of a new religious community should never be forgotten. But, and then I come to my perhaps most crucial remark where we could have a difference. I think you are underestimating, generally speaking, generational change. I've just done a research based on existing material between Amsterdam and Rotterdam. We had sort of 100 criteria of integration on all different fields. And if you look at them, it suggests definitely more generational change than you, in your gloomy vision, imply. Of course, we should always remember that still of today, as in Germany, in the Netherlands, the first generation is larger than the second generation, but your side remark about the third and fourth generation simply doesn't hold empirically, because if you look at the third generation, it's already very, very small, only in its beginnings. If we look at those groups about whom you are talking, you know, their migration started in the 60s. We're in the second generation, the third generation. It's almost the same story as in the Netherlands, started almost at the same time. And if you look at the third generation, for example, in Amsterdam, it's almost non-existent still. Very, very small as compared to the second, and even insignificant as compared to the first. So the whole question of where generational change will bring us is, in my view, open. But then, if I look at the outcomes of this research, for example, you say the Muslim communities have a high fertility rate, many children in those families. It's simply not true. If you look at the second generation, you see a steep decline in the size of families, also in the Muslim communities. So I looked, for example, at the statistics of when women in the Muslim communities, the Moroccan community, Turkish community, in the Netherlands, get their first child. In 1994, it was at the age of 22. Now it's at the age of 28. So in 15 years' time, you see almost a convergence with the native average. Not completely there. Native average is 32 years old, but definitely the size of families in the Muslim communities in the Netherlands, but that's true in Germany as well. If you look at the generational change, you see somewhat more movement than you imply. Also, if I look at educational performance in the second generation, I would say, I would qualify it as a growing divide, a growing polarization. On the one hand, you see the emergence of a middle class. On the other hand, you see too many, and too many literally means too many, who are stuck on the lower sides of our educational system. So you see within this supposed migrant community, which isn't a community at all, but is a general term under which different lives are caught. But if you look at the second generation already, and I predict the third generation will give way to a growing pluralism in the destinies of those whom grandparents came from Morocco or Turkey. If we look at crime, then I would say, yes, there is quite a high crime rate in the Moroccan community, but definitely also in the Netherlands, in the Antillean community. They strike out definitely both. If we look at the Turkish community, the crime rate there is significantly lower than the Moroccan community, Surinamese community as well. So the whole question, which I think determines far more, is family culture, and religion can play a role there, but I would say those who tend to be seduced by crime are not particularly described by devout religious obedience, on the contrary. So I think it's more general. When you look at migration patterns, the breakdown of family structures, the breakdown of parental authority, which also explains why in the first generation the crime rates are very low, and in the second generation, typically, which is caught between the land of arrival and the land of destiny, the land of origin, then you see how much they are caught between different codes of authority. Two conclusions very briefly. First, I do agree that we need a restrictive immigration policy, but I disagree that ethnicity or religion should be the guiding factor. I would say let's adopt what Canada is doing, let's adopt what Australia is doing, let's look at qualifications, and let's be very clear about that our great question is, what are we going to do with the second, third generation living already here? What is their answer to them? They're definitely above average unemployment, still also in the second generation. The welfare system has a lot to do with that, I guess. So there I would look at those questions. With regard to integration, I would say, yes, we need more emphasis, but what is the normative framework? I would say the normative framework is reciprocity. Simply, the native population cannot ask more, but shouldn't ask less of newcomers than it's asking of itself. So the criterion here is civic integration, and I think the whole immigration and integration debate has somehow brought into the open our weakness in terms of a culture of citizenship. But that is true for our society, generally speaking. So, for example, when we talk about religious freedom, we should tell everybody it's a right, but it entails a responsibility to defend the same right for those with whom you deeply disagree. That is a problem within the Muslim community. It's also a problem within the majority population, as we see in Switzerland. So yes, it confronts the Muslim community, should confront them, but it should also answer the question raised by a minister in Germany of Turkish descent, who said, why is it that we are told all the time as Muslim communities, separation of state and church, and that we still have crucifixes in our public school, on the school wall, and then you can't say it's our tradition. Then either your tradition is the separation of state and church, or your tradition is Christian, but then minorities can say it's our tradition to have our symbols in our public sphere. So I would say let's remain truthful to the idea of citizenship, also in its normative sense, but that opens a possibility for conflict, not only with Muslim communities, but also should confront majority populations. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Paul Scheffer. Indeed, there's water underneath your tables. What's it? Tabernacles. Anyway, and you have to wait till the end of the of the debate to have a water or a beer. Mr. Zazen, you made notes. You probably have a few things to answer.
I would like to make some remarks. First, concerning the vitality of our culture, this is indeed a question which I don't have any clear answers for, but I think that there is an answer for the question why the demography is not the subject in the media. So look at the media, look at the average, not the journalists, count their marriages, count their divorces, count those who have always been unmarried, count the number of children, count the share of those who don't have children at all, and then you can see that the raising the family is an the exception and the, not the rule that within the media crowd. So I assume, or I, yes, well, I assume or I suspect that the family and the children don't belong to the normal environment of the journalists anymore, and that therefore there are no the subject for them, and so are not the long term the consequences as well. This is the first point which I want to make. The second point is France. France is an interesting example. And there you see the long-term effects of debates and of the feeling of the society. France used to have the biggest population in the Europe at the site of the Napoleon.